Well, let me just say that my metaphor for this group, the more I think about it, is that the all the lessons, if you put them all together, it's kind of like a 50-mile yard sale. And each of us, again, I really do truly feel that the success path is meant to be, even though it's a lot of lessons, but it's up to each individual to customize these lessons to your needs, right? So I'm trying to address a lot of different needs. And I do feel that regardless of how advanced we are, including myself, like I am learning so much from having to think about the master classes that I feel like I'm almost starting over here. And I love that. I'm addressing those who may still feel that they're behind. We are all getting out of the car at the same place and starting this 50-mile yard sale. But we all know that some of you are going to be attracted to the used book section. You know, the person who has a lot of used books. Another person is going to move on and go right past that one and stop off at the one with the antiques. And that's kind of how it is. It's kind of a la carte. The lessons are there, and I hope you will go through them all. At least at the very minimum, listen to the videos. Because there might be something there that I don't want you to miss. And this is what I'm seeing in the Facebook. Various comments like, wow, I didn't think that I needed to learn more about color, but I started to do these swatches and now I'm hooked, you know, that kind of a realization. And we, you know, and I think this is what happens to all of us. And I'd love to know how you guys feel in the chat, wherever we are. On the superficial level, when we read, let's say the title of one of my videos, we're like, oh, Pam wants us to do color swatches. Well, I did that back 20 years ago. I don't need to do that again. And at first glance, you might feel that way, but I want to reinforce one thing. And that is that the lessons that I'm giving you are never meant to be do it once and you're done. These are things that we must repeat our entire lives. We are never done. Sure, you may know a lot about color. You may know a lot about mark making, but we are not the same person today that we were yesterday. And if we did color swatches 10, 15 years ago, I would think that our affinity for certain colors or color palettes may have changed. And that's what this is meant to do, is perhaps make us open our eyes to how we may have changed. We want to catch those moments as our intellect changes and we acquire more knowledge and we live longer. Everything that happens in our lives can potentially change the way we see the world.
Just wanted to say, Pam, you're getting some great feedback in the chat. And like, for example, Carol said that she does the exercises, give it no matter what, and that she feels it's important to refresh and keep learning. And the same with Belinda. She says that, you know, she's benefiting from doing them, plus the Facebook page. And Ian says that module 3 is crucial to moving forward as an artist. Without it, it's like trying to play baseball without a bat, which I thought was very interesting, you know, a nice little visual there. And Mindy is getting so much from them all. And Milica is doing yard art with her daughter's neighborhood. Aww. And reserved a spot. And that sounds like fun.
Oh my gosh, that's great.
Yeah, so there's some really good stuff.
Well, nothing makes me happier than to see all of these wonderful pro members right here in front of me. All little thumbnails. Oh my gosh, you're a grid. Everybody is a grid. Oh my gosh, I'm so excited because everybody knows that color has so many, it's like a chameleon and it's ever changing. It has many facets to it. And it depends on what color is next to. It's not even as simple as what we think. It's what is the color next to? What's around it? Color is very complex. So we spend, you know, a good amount of time with color. In the same way, shape. Now, shape is the next masterclass that I'm so excited about because as I was putting everything together, I realized myself how, sure, I have my shapes that I gravitate toward, but after putting together these videos, I'm like, well, wait a minute. I need to reassess what I think about shape. The same thing has happened after I did the mark making thing. And I don't know if this is happening for you, but I would love to know if it is happening for you. And that's actually what I do see in the Facebook group. If I had to do a cross section of the posts I'm seeing, daily, weekly, and then look at the last 3 months. The bird's eye view I'm getting, so if I'm flying over the group, what I'm seeing is growth, progress. I'm seeing excitement, discovery. I'm seeing the language change within the group. And this is a very gradual process, but the longer that you have been posting and attempt this visual language of art, like Susan Crew, I'm going to point her out because she has been trying very hard to describe her posts using the visual language of art. And I think I wrote on one of hers, visual language alert, everybody look here, because it takes effort. It's not easy. And we don't normally do this. This is, again, a very different Facebook group where, you know, it's not to say that every single post has to have this, but if it does, you yourself, the poster, are going to grow from this faster. The more we use any language, you can look at this as a foreign language if you want to. You've got to use it or you lose it. And I'm hoping that as we do bring in new members, I have to say that just by virtue of the way we write about our art is an indication of how much we've grown, how much we've learned, and how much connection there is between our own understanding of ourselves and our art. Because in order to talk about it and say, I'm an artist, I've been painting for however many years, and you know, I really am drawn toward color because of this and that, or I really love texture and that's what I feature in my work. So the whole thing about being able to talk to people comfortably and not run away has to do with understanding who you are, not just that, but being able to describe with words, because we are verbal. We need to have confidence in the visual world. And we also need to have confidence in the verbal world that describes the visual world. You might be the best artist in the world, but if you can't describe what you're doing, you're going to feel inadequate. You're going to feel like you don't have confidence. It has nothing to do with your art. It has to do with the ability to talk about how you feel. Okay. So that's just, I just wanted to share that with you because I'm so impressed. I'm literally so excited when I get to review all the work at the end of the month and prepare for these calls. For me, it's such a reward. Like, I just want you to know that I feel very grateful to have this group because each one of you is very valued. I'm looking for diverse examples of the exercises, projects, whatever that we're doing in each masterclass. So what I found interesting here, I love this variety here of images. Again, kind of like what I do is I scroll through the guides and I scroll through several times and I save many, many images. And then I kind of look through them. I'm kind of curating, right? And of all the images I have in a folder, I'm visually saying, okay, which are good examples of diversity here? Like how are we as a group doing the same assignment or exercise in a totally different way, because they're all valid. There's no right or wrong. So starting here with Deborah Searle, what I really loved here, I mean, she chose Indian yellow and she plus black and white, so a monochromatic color palette. And many of you did this, but she actually showed what she did. So she showed her color swatch and then she showed what she did with her leftover colors, right? And she said, I learned a lot. And I love to read that. Down here, Joy Carter, I loved how she had a notebook. I loved how she was doing her swatches on paper from books. So book papers, what a great idea. In fact, that is a very, it's very visually appealing to me. I like how she used her Sharpie to delineate these little, she made it into a grid, you know, like that's a grid. Okay, there's another type of grid. And then she put like, you know, she labeled things. By the way, labeling when you do color swatches is so important because we kind of get into this and then we're like, oh my gosh, what color, which green was that? And I've so many times forgotten to put the colors. It's like, darn it, because I can guess, but unless I mix the colors again, I may not quite be right. That's how tricky color is. So labeling, she's got magic mix here. And then Lisa, we had a great conversation. I've been having some really fun conversations with many of you. You know, for some of us, we actually get this reaction almost like we're going to be sick. And if you're feeling that way, there is nothing wrong with you. In fact, it's the opposite. And I told Lisa, it's like, oh my gosh, your personal voice is telling you run faster, run away from the grid. That's not you, right? And She was really alarmed when she first saw these swatches, and she kind of got nauseous looking at them. So she found her own way to do it. And, you know, as a watercolorist, and obviously if you love watercolor, you may love these transitional areas where one color bleeds into the other, and you're getting all the color mixing that you need to know about. In fact, you're kind of seeing what two colors make up this color, and you know what two colors make up this color. So it's a different way to express color mixing, but it's every bit as valid. And she's labeled her color. So that's it. You know, you can do it any way you want. Robert Simmons also had this where he's showing the glazing and how the glazing changed. Does anyone, I'm going to show you another slide. When you have leftover paint, yeah, don't throw it away. Throw it into a painting. Because look at how great that is. You're not going to forget this palette, because that's a very good example of this palette right here. And then over here, Colleen Shea. Now she had a question. So how do you guys, let's just open this up. If anyone's raising their hand and wants to share a little discovery.
Well, a couple people have said that they find doing the swatches in grid form is very therapeutic.
I just loved it. I mean, it's just so much fun to get up here and play with colors that I don't normally use. I have a real aversion to purple, but my youngest son informed me that eggplant's kind of his favorite color. So I thought, oh, wow, I haven't played with that. I better create something. So it's just been a gas.
Yeah, good, good. You know, the thing, I think what really impressed me, I do believe that I had ordered a book at some point. It could have been, you know, a while ago. I don't think I have it anymore, but it was like a historical book. One of the first artists who ever did a book of swatches, and it led to Pantone. I don't really know, but you have to wonder where Pantone got started. And if you were to do some research on that, you know, somebody had to have done a lot of work. And his book was probably written in the perhaps done, and these swatches were done in like the 1800s, you know, and he was very neat and organized, and it was a book and it got published. And, you know, I looked in the feedback comments before I ordered the book, and they're like, well, you know, some of the colors are not as true as they probably are, but again, it's a reproduction. And I thought, wow, imagine if you had that. That was originally what gave me the idea. So the reason why this is never done is because basically it's an infinite exercise. You're never going in your lifetime, you're never going to be able to combine every possible color combination that you have. Even one color, you're finding that it's a world. And then you mix one color with another, and it's like, oh my gosh, it's like explosion. And then three colors almost seems like it's not even doable, because you have to have such a large palette. When I started to do three colors, my palette became a 6-foot table. And I now think, oh my gosh, I just never quite gave color enough of a chance to impress me with all it could do. So I hope you're discovering that as well.